Okay, I have exactly 10 a.m., so we'll go ahead and get started. Hello, everyone, and welcome to our session today, Supporting Minority STEM Students Across an Alliance of Community Colleges. Before we begin, I want to cover some housekeeping items. This session will be recorded. Please leave your cameras and microphones muted throughout the session. If you have any questions, please use the Q&A feature, as the chat feature is not active. We will get to as many of the questions as we can at the end of the session. And now it is my pleasure to introduce our presenter, Amber Griffin. A native of Cincinnati, Ohio, Amber Griffin currently serves as the Senior Academic Coordinator in the Mathematics and Science Unit at Central Piedmont Community College in Charlotte, North Carolina. As a graduate of Johnson C. Smith University, her educational background includes a bachelor's degree in mathematics and graduate studies in applied statistics. After serving as an academic success coach at JCSU and a TRIO academic advisor at Livingstone College, Amber Griffin joined CPCC in 2015 as the program coordinator for the CPCC-led North Carolina STEM Alliance. With grant funds from the National Science Foundation, the primary goal of the NCSA is to increase the number of underrepresented minority students who transfer to universities to earn bachelor's degrees in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics disciplines. After being promoted to NCSA project manager in 2019, Ms. Griffin expanded her sphere of influence by providing additional leadership to NCSA partners across the state. Amber is a data-informed, passionate, and genuine leader that has a proven track record of placing the needs of others before her own preferences so that all involved can be better positioned to exuberantly move forward towards excellence. So, as I said, we will offer an opportunity for questions at the end of the session if time allows, but the session will end promptly at 9:50, so you will have time to get to the next session. So now, Amber, I will turn it over to you.
Thank you, Wendy. I will share my screen. Good morning, everyone. It is such a pleasure for me to be here today. And thank you, Wendy, for that warm welcome and introduction. Today, I will be talking about supporting minority STEM students across an alliance of community colleges. And yes, in 2015, Central Piedmont was awarded a National Science Foundation award of $1.5 million. And the project was for the Lewis Stokes Alliances for Minority Participation. And I was actually a part of this program when I went to Johnson C. Smith. And of course, it was been a wonderful pleasure for me to be able to come back to be a part of it on the staff side of it. And locally, we called it the North Carolina STEM Alliance. Central Piedmont was the lead institution, and we had the grant for 6 years, two iterations. So for the first 3 years, the first iteration, we partnered with Davis and Davie and Guilford Tech. And for the second 3 years, we partnered with Guilford Tech and Foresight Tech. And as far as how the staffing was concerned, of course, when you have grants, you have principal investigators, and we had some at each of the schools. And then there was a project manager that was housed at Central Piedmont. and STEM navigator, which is what I came in as, STEM navigator slash program coordinator at first, then moved up to the project manager role. And then we had math or STEM coaches at each of the institutions as well. And the overall goal of the project was to increase the number of the percentage of underrepresented students that transfer into a STEM related field. And we had many, we had a couple program objectives and strategies that we used to get to accomplish those goals and objectives. And so I want to highlight that our strategy, we have a strategy for student retention, for transferring students, and also giving them an opportunity to participate in undergraduate research, even at the community college level. So very exciting things that we will be talking about today. And so today I'll be talking about the different activities that the schools had and how we did many, many of them very similarly, but then there were a few differences, but all towards the same goal of increasing the percentage of underrepresented students that transferred. And so strategy one with student retention and progression. So we'll start out with talking about STEM prep, STEM navigation, math coaching, and STEM Academy. And our STEM prep program is our program that we did for 11th graders, 12th graders, and some of the community college students that may have been early in on their STEM classes or hadn't really got to their STEM classes. And so it was a great way to give 11th and 12th graders early exposure to STEM related classes, talk about some of the current practices in the STEM fields, and give them some exploration into the career opportunities. And our goal was that even though we were starting with giving the opportunity to those that were in 11th and 12th grade, that they would become either dually enrolled or either become a student at the community college and enter into our college level program that I will talk about after we get done talking about STEM prep and become what we call a fellow. Now the STEM prep program is one that was a little different at each school. And so at Central Piedmont, we had the students would take two courses that were based through our college and continuing education courses. And we started off offering it as 8 weeks during the fall and the spring semesters. And they would do them in the evening. And we found that that was pretty busy for them to be at high school all day and then to come and to do a program a few days a week. And so we had much more success in our 4-week summer program, where we would involve the students in taking those two classes through our college and continuing education courses, where all students had to take a math class. And then they were actually able to choose between taking a class relating to science, IT, or engineering. And so we had them switch off, and half of them would take math, and then the other half would be in a different subject area, and then switch off. And through those courses, the math was to give them a good review. We know that math is very essential in all the areas of STEM for them to have a good background. So then we had them, they were able to decide, do I want to learn more, or do I, you know, have a diehard interest in science and IT or engineering? And each of them were project-based, so they did projects through each of the courses. And at the end, in our closing program, they were able to present on what their projects were. And through the second iteration, I would say we began offering career panels, where we would have professionals come in and talk with the students about their day-to-day STEM careers that they were engaged in, to give them some insight on the workforce. And so that was really, really good. And they were able to ask questions and learn more about maybe careers they hadn't thought of or careers that they were thinking of going into. The other thing that we did was to give more engagement with the parents. And so, of course, we would have them come in to the orientations at the beginning. And then as we build on the career panels, we thought it would be good to engage the parents here as well, so that sometimes a parent may not understand or even know, you know, what their child has interest in, or maybe a way to encourage them along if they already know what area they have interest in. So we thought it was good to engage the parents there. And then, of course, as I mentioned before, the closing program, they would, parents were able to come back to see what their students had learned, their children had learned, as well as hear about their projects. At Guilford Tech, they did something fairly similar, but they actually conducted theirs through their Summer Bridge program. And so the students were duly enrolled, and the two courses that they took were actually college level courses. So they took Math 171 and English 111. And so they were, you know, again, taking college level courses, and then they developed some contextualized curriculum design to do, even outside of those courses, some STEM exposure pieces and labs and different things to give them some other exposure outside of the Math 171 and the English 111. And then they had graduate students that they would use and come in as well and give them supplemental assistance through the Math 171 class. And so they ran theirs during the summer session at Guilford Tech, so that whatever that summer summer classes schedule was after they had got out of high school, of course. And those students almost, you know, they were definitely agreeing to participate as a duly enrolled student with the goal that they would go to Guilford in the fall. And at Foresight Tech, they actually did like a 1 week boot camp the week before classes started with those that were interested in starting at Foresight in the fall. And so during that 1 week, they spent a lot of time on giving them exposure to different speakers as well through career panels, and also doing visits to different labs and company visits. And they had a project that all of the students worked on that was a rocket building project. And so through the rocket building project, you can see up in the right-hand corner at the end of the week, they had a challenge where, or a competition to see how far their rocket could go at the end. And so that was always good fun for them. So as you can see through STEM prep at Foresight, at Guilford, and at Central Piedmont, different variations of the program, but still with the overall goal of giving that early exposure there. And so here you can see a few more pictures from some of the students that participated in STEM prep. And I wanted to take a pause right here for, I wanted to pose a question out there. So like I said, these were, STEM prep was one of those areas that the schools did a little bit differently, but still matching to that overall goal. I'd like to see, is there anyone that maybe is doing something similar at your college? How does it differ from what you just heard about with what we did at those three schools? If you want to take yourself off of mute for a second, and maybe I'll hear from one or two people or either the question and answer area.
There's not an option to unmute, but they can put it in the Q&A.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Anyone doing anything similar or at your colleges? maybe a little, having something a little differently, feel free to put it in the question and answer section. Well, if not, I guess this is brand spanking new earth shattering things here. Now I see one comment there. Here's some coming in. Thank you, Benjamin says, I'm trying to develop a better streamline for STEM into allied health sciences. Oh, great. Yes, through the National Science Foundation, the focus for us was on the science where we could had to avoid the allied health. So definitely that is needed. Let's see, at LC State in Knoxville, we have a grant to do a 1 week IT summer camp on Saturdays. Oh, great. And SOAR program. It was a week before the fall term. Oh, great. Yes, so definitely early exposure, as I know, I'm sure we can all agree that that is very crucial as you think of, you know, those things that you get asked as a young person, what do you want to be when you grow up? Or, you know, what is a family member ask you? What do you want to do? So obviously having that early exposure to figure those things out is really great. So thank you all for your feedback there. Those are great. So moving toward our college level program. So again, at our college level program, we had students that participated that were in our Associate of Science program, Associate of Engineering program, and our applied sciences that we're gonna be transferring into STEM degrees. And so at Central Piedmont Community College, we served up to 50 students at Forsyth and at Guilford and at Davison Davy. They served in between 15 to 20 students. And again, those were students that were considered fellows and full participants in our program. And at each of the schools, we have what we call STEM navigators that worked very, very closely with each of the students. This is the role that I had started in with at Central Piedmont as a STEM navigator, where we work closely on the students with their academic and career goals. And so working with them and meeting with them at least three times, I would say, a semester, sometimes more. You had some students that would come by every day. So definitely working with them semester by semester, each semester looking at, okay, what do we need to do to be successful in the classroom? What do we need to do to be successful in what our transfer plans are? And really having those conversations as early as possible with them and giving them as many letting them know as many options as are available. And then as well as career goals and looking at what things we can be doing now to help you to be better prepared towards your career. So whether that would be participating in internships or work-based learning opportunities, et cetera, et cetera. And the navigators worked with the students. That was a majority of what they did. But the other part that they also did was facilitate and coordinate workshops that we'll talk about here shortly, college visits and company visits. And so through what we called our STEM Academy is where we had our interactive workshops that where we talked about being ready for the classes that we were taking. So whether it was talking about study skills, whether it was talking about increasing the awareness in their career in their careers through career panels, gaining familiarity with some of the up and coming areas in the STEM fields. And we opened our workshops up to all students that were at the college, all and majority that had interests also had interests in STEM. So it wasn't just those cohorts that I talked about, those 50 students, those 15 students, they were actually open to more than just the students that we were serving. So that was a great way to be able to broaden and give some exposure to other students that were also on the campus. And we did have quite a few that would take advantage of coming and participating, especially when we had our career panels and we would do mock interviewing and many of the workshops that we did and even that we had at each of the schools. It was pretty much very similar at each of the schools. So not much difference, although, you know, we would also collaborate with some of the career services on campus, financial aid offices on campus. And even at Central Piedmont, we would have some of the leaders, the student, the fellow leaders to conduct some workshops and to have some connections amongst just the students to work on activities, STEM related activities together. So those were really good. And here's another picture of some of the workshops and our school visits and company visits that we have done that I will be talking about here momentarily. Our STEM coaching. So the assistance that we gave students while they are taking classes, we started out as actually math coaches, and we saw quickly that students may also need assistance in other STEM-related courses. And so there are math coaches that may also have be able to help students in other courses. Like we have students to have a need for chemistry. So we hired a coach that would be able to assist them in Chem 151 and Chem 152, as well as the other schools in IT, and some were able to assist in some of the other STEM related classes, biology and physics. And so it was really helpful, I know, for the students to be able to have that support with that. And with Guilford, Davison, Davie, and Forsyth having a smaller cohort, they were able to do some one-on-one assistance with the students at Central Piedmont because we had such a larger cohort of 50 students that we grouped them by what classes they were taking. And so all the students that were taking 171 would meet with their coach at certain times throughout the week to get assistance in that. We also encouraged at all schools that they have study groups and work with the students that are in the same courses as them. And lastly, another way that, again, we tried to engage all the STEM students at the college, it was open to, you know, more than just the fellows, is that, and this was a little different at each of the schools. So like at Central Piedmont, we offer clinics for the STEM students. And we did this about three times a semester, and where we have maybe closer to maybe a test time or just midpoints throughout the semester to kind of review some of the topics that they have learned so far in their math and chemistry classes. And I know at Forsyth, they were even ambitious and they offered it almost weekly for students to have another place to be able to get assistance in their math classes. So strategy two, we're talking about the transfer and workforce experiences. So in transferring, we had many college visits. We would do those at least 2 to 3 times a semester where we would take students to some of the colleges in the state and even nearby. We've done Virginia Tech but we partnered with the universities to have visits so that they could see inside the labs, they could get connections to some of the support services, as well as giving them through the STEM Navigator, giving them guidance on their transfer destination, looking at financial resources to support their transfer goals. And during those times of this grant, we saw mainly that the top three schools that students would transfer were UNC Charlotte, North Carolina A&T, and NC State. And we actually broadened over the years, I would say, as we did more visits and different things. I think that helped to broaden to give exposure to schools. And although the students had interest in transferring, we still wanted to give them exposure to the workforce. And so there were different times throughout the year that we would partner with local employers. Each of the schools, we would try to do so together, or if there was a company that was nearby, or if it was something we could do or end up doing virtually, especially the last few years during the pandemic, having conversations virtually. But this was a really great opportunity for students to kind of get a hands-on and walk through the labs and see different things at various companies. So then I have another question to kind of break up me talking here. Are there different things at your colleges that you're doing to give meaningful exposure to the workforce, even for those students that want to transfer? So again, if you wanna share in the Q&A section on things that may be going on to give students exposure for workforce, even for those that want to transfer. Oh, good. Thank you, Casey. They offer student internships in their IT department, exposing them to open source software. Absolutely. 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 Thank you, Lauren. Casey? Yep. Oh, that's great, Laura. They have internships starting at the high school level. They try to bring in speakers from the industry into the classroom. We do work at the high schools as well for significant days. Okay, good. All right. Thank you very much for your input on this. These are good things. So now continuing on with, there was one more comment. We've had students leave the program early to entry-level positions because of the experience they received. Yes, that will happen. I like to still encourage them to finish their degree. But yes, continuing to talk about our college level program here. So in strategy 3, to focus on undergraduate research experiences. So at each school, we all know the importance of undergraduate research experience and giving them some of those skills to really continue to build and to brush up on. And things that are looked upon as very valuable for the workforce and the critical thinking skills, communication skills, especially even as I, you know, speak with students later on after coming through the program. You know, they are really, really nervous when it comes to presenting for their research when they come through. But as they continue to go through school and working now, they do understand how important it was to build upon those communication skills, team building skills. We all, you know, have to having to work in teams in the workforce, and they were able to increase their subject knowledge, subject area knowledge, and prepare for the four-year school and research at that level so that they will even know what research is. And so it was really great to be able to provide that exposure to the students. And so at each of the schools and at the at Central Piedmont, we actually had students working in groups with a faculty member or a staff member, or even a community member. We've had be mentors, but at the Foresight Tech at Davis and Davy and at Guilford, they sometimes were able to do the one-on-one with the faculty mentor because of their size. But regardless, they were able to go through and learn about research methods and conduct a research project. And every spring, we hosted a symposia at each of the schools. And even during the pandemic, you can see up in the right-hand corner, we had to do virtual symposiums the last few years because of that. And so that didn't stop us to give the students the opportunity to participate in, in research. And I do apologize here with the data that I was focused here on the last couple of years, but those first few years, Davis and Davy did have some students that participated in research. So definitely they did as well. And so again, I also thought it was neat that even though we had a symposium to encompass all three schools, that the schools would do one at their individual schools as well. And even they would have opportunity where the parents of the college students and family members, and that they could come and to see their child or husband or wife or mom or dad present their research. So I thought that was really good opportunity for the families and friends and families to see that as well. And we didn't stop there with giving all of the students the opportunity to participate in research. We were able to be fortunate to build partnerships with some of the neighboring universities where students were able to, our fellows were able to participate, some of them in summer REUs. And so some of the colleges that participated, or some of the places where fellows participated, were UNC Charlotte, Davidson College, Virginia Tech, North Carolina A&T, Syracuse University, that also had our same funding program, and Wake Forest University. And so students were able to really see outside of our four walls of each of the community colleges what was going on in research beyond that. And even a step further, and many times we may have been the only community college students at the table at some of these conferences sometimes, but one that I'm sure is familiar to many of us, the State of North Carolina Undergraduate Research and Creativity Symposium. That is one that we frequent almost every year, and where students could go and present their research that they did with us through the program, or either the summer research that they participated in. And then, of course, there were a few other conferences that we were able to take the students to that were outside of our symposium. And again, this was something that all of the schools, we all went to and were represented together. And here's a few more pictures from some of the symposiums and students presenting, and even a picture of some of the alumni students. We went to A&T, and there are students from all of the different schools there represented to speak to the students when we went to visit. So now to talk about a couple challenges that we had throughout the project that we didn't allow to stop us at all, and even, you know, made strides in making things better. And I believe even with the initial communication and having three schools and trying to get a hold of everybody and make sure we were all staying on track and going towards the goals, that I think we really made great headway with our communication. It was definitely key in a lot of the successes that we were able to have, in that all three schools were able to kind of stay on track and stay on the goal. We did have some challenges with data collection and our evaluation model, as we were three schools trying to make sure that we stayed, that we had the data and had everything together, many pieces here with communication and, you know, change of staffing and just the whole, but is something that we, you know, continually work toward improving those things as well. And then post-award sustainability is something that we are also working on now, where I know at Foresight and Guilford that there was another STEM grant that they were awarded. And here at Central Piedmont, there's been a couple of companies that we have been able to work with to give us some sustainability with our research component, as well as those clinics that we did for the math clinics. We've been able to sustain those, but we are still continuing to explore ways to sustain all aspects of the program. So those are a couple of the challenges that we've had. But again, going back to the communication, and those, that was definitely one challenge I think we had overcome, and increasing our communication all the way from, you know, the day-to-day workers to the administration, all the way through up to the presidents. And we had an advisory board for our grant. And so this is just some of the communication and different ways and how often we communicated with them. And so now at this time, I'll take any questions. As you can see from here, we had three schools that, you know, are able to work together for this common goal of increasing the number of underrepresented minority students. And I believe that, you know, that we were able to do it well. And, you know, you can do it at your school individually. You can also partner and work with various schools as well. So feel free to let me know if you have any questions or if there's anything that I can do to assist you in what you may be doing at your schools.
I just want to remind participants to use the Q&A section for questions.
Thank you.
It looks like you did a really good job conveying all the information, Amber.
Thank you. Yeah, I see one coming in, very insightful. Thank you, Laura.
And I believe if anyone wants to discuss anything, you can raise your hand, I believe, and I can allow you to talk.
And here's my contact information, my email address. Feel free to contact me. Okay, I see someone has raised their hand.
Okay. Let's see. I'm not seeing who it is.
It was Blaine Winford.
There it is. Okay. Okay, Blaine, I believe you can talk now. Just unmute your microphone.
Hey there, Amber. I just want to say first, like, great presentation. Secondly, I'm actually a Spanish instructor, and I just I thought, you know, just coming to this presentation, kind of see what's going on with students who might be going to STEM was in a way useful for me, because one, I can kind of, okay, if some of my students, like if we had such a program, I kind of see what some students are kind of going through in terms of like their study habits, that kind of thing. Secondly, and equally important is, okay, in my Spanish classes and perhaps like some experimental Spanish course, I'd like to see how I could like possibly integrate world languages and interest in world languages into STEM programs, you know, given, you know, I had studied abroad in Ecuador, for instance, and Ecuador was a place that's huge for biological research and things like that. And I think it's kind of an interesting time for like both, you know, STEM, but also trying to apply it, like, do, you know, how would I say it? Trying to take language learning in a different place too, right? You know, leaning more towards professions that are becoming, you know, more and more, prominent, you know, particularly in STEM. I know I'm not making a lot of sense. I just wanted to come off. I just wanted to make a comment and say, hey, excellent presentation.
Oh, no, thank you, Blaine. And I agree. Try to find that connection. I took Spanish, you know, in high school and college as well. And I think with diversity and being able to reach that, the younger generation as well, that's going to be key and important as we try to, you know, continue to build the diversity in STEM. And so to be able to get the word out to, you know, the Spanish populations and other, you know, populations that may not, you know, speak the language or be native. So no, there is a bridge there that can happen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Blaine. And Casey Starwalt has a hand up. So go ahead, Casey.
Hey, can you hear me okay, Amber? This is
Casey. I can.
Once again, Casey Starwalt, Stanley Community College.
Which community college? I'm sorry. Uh-oh, he got cut off.
Oops, did I do that?
Yeah,
sorry about that, Casey.
Can you hear me?
Yes. I can now.
Thank you. I'm with Stanley Community College.
Oh, Stanley. Gotcha.
Location, North Carolina. Want to open by thank you for your time. Appreciate the presentation. First I wanted to clarify in my chat message that when I was stating that we do offer an internship for an IT department internship for our students complete their college programs. I was referencing that we they get this work experience, so they're often able to find jobs and don't need the IT internship. So they tend to leave after a few months. So it's definitely a good program for our students to get them into the IT field quickly while they also continue their education.
Okay. Oh, no problem.
But
that's great, though.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, it's been an excellent program. We've been running for several years. We've had a lot of our individuals enter the local community in IT. The question I had for you, more so specific to STEM studies, is our program heads in the past, we try to do student outreach, and our instructors go out to the high schools and try to recruit for STEM programs. One thing they're really trying to push, we're in a small rural area, but they're trying to push for a more, to try to add diversity to those programs and try to help, especially young women, be confident in going into those STEM fields and try to increase increase the statistics and see that growth and that diversity. What would you state as a recommendation on how to approach this and to help encourage young women and young minority individuals to encourage them to approach those programs and join those programs? What can we do to improve that?
So I think, you know, connection, I know you connect with finding the high school or someone in the high school that can give you that connection with the parents and trying to work with them, as well as maybe having some programming where they can get exposure to those things. So like something I didn't talk about today was that we partner with the North Carolina Science Festival, and where you can have, you know, different programming even at the elementary school age. And so we would have an elementary school nearby to come over to work with the children on different topics. So if there's some way to have some sort of programming where they get the exposure, so you may pique the interest of them, you know, have some relevant relating things to be able to give them some exposure to pique their interest. And then from there say, hey, if you want more things like this, you know, we're going to be offering such and such at our school. And really, so then that would be one thing. And then the second thing would be to really try to find some connections with those at the high schools that have connections with those students. Because when a person has connections with those students, you know, there's some mentors and things, or somebody would tell, that's how I found out about research. My advisor, you know, said, hey, I had no idea what research was in college, and it was like, hey, you should try this thing or do this. And so, you know, there's some people that are really have those close connections with the students that can give them that exposure to trying what program you have to offer.
Well, excellent. Thank you for your time, Amber, and for presenting today. Have a great day.
Thank you. I know we're running close to time.
We are close to time, and I don't see any other hands raised or any questions in the Q&A box. So okay. I want to thank you, Amber. You did a great job with the presentation today, and I'd like to thank all of our participants for attending and participating in the supporting minority STEM students across an alliance of community colleges session. I hope you enjoy the remainder of the conference, and recordings will be available after the conference, and the links will be sent to you.
Thank you so much, Wendy, and thank you all for your participation and for attending and listening today.
Thank you, Amber. Enjoy the conference.